Hello, welcome back. So in the previous part, we have solved a problem to calculate the compressive strength of a steel column. And in that steel column, we have taken a single section, which was I section. Well, in this case, now we are going to find out the compressive strength of steel column. And in this case, it will be a compound section, or sometimes we call it built up section. Well, built up section or compound sections are those sections which are composed of two or more sections. So like in this case, there may be a I section along with say plates. If it is connected with the plates, then it will become compound section. Similarly, instead of I section, there may be two channel sections. So if we compose two channel sections to form a single unit, then it will be called a compound or built up section. So how do we find out compressive strength of such built-up section? We will look in this case. So this is the problem that we have to solve. So in this case, it is being asked that we have to calculate the compressive strength of a compound column. And compound column is consisting of ISHB. ISHB stands for Indian Standard Heavy Beam, which is the I section. So it is consisting ISHB 250 at the rate of 54.7 kg per meter. And along with the I section, there is one cover plate, and the size of cover plate is 300 mm by 16 mm. So it says that one cover plate is provided on each flange as shown in the figure, and the length of member is 4 meter. Also, it has mentioned the end condition, which means the column from the bottom, it is fixed, and from the top, it is hinged. So this is the end condition which is given in the column, and this end conditions are generally given to calculate the effective length, because this is the unsupported or actual clear length of the column. So in the diagram, you can see this one is the I section, and this is called the flange, and this part is called the web, and this is the flange. So this is the top flange, and this is the bottom flange. So this I section is provided with the cover plate on top flange and also on the bottom flange. Also, the size of plate is given, which is 300 mm by 16 mm. So this part is 300 mm, and the thickness of this plate is given here, which is 16 mm. So both plate has the same size. So now when this I section is provided with the cover plate, now we have to find out the compressive strength of this compound section. So to find out the compressive strength, again, we will follow the same process. Design compressive strengths, generally we express that as PD, and PD is the product of FCD into AE. Well, AE is the gross area of the section. So in this case, AE will be the area of cross section of I section plus area of cross section of this plate and this plate. So that will be the area of this will be the effective area. And then we have to find out the FCD, and we know that this FCD depends on the value of lambda. Lambda is called slenderness ratio. And slenderness ratio depends on two parameters. One is the effective length. This lambda depends on the effective length and the radius of gyration. So first we have to find out the property of the I section, and the size of plate is already given. So in this case, the radius of gyration we can find out from the table. In the previous case, what we have done is we have found the radius of gyration directly from the steel table. But in this case, what we have to do is we have to calculate radius of gyration, because there are three sections which are there. So radius of gyration for the I section we can directly find out from the steel table, but what about the of these two plates? So we have to calculate radius of gyration of these two plates also. Now radius of gyration is actually, the formula for radius of gyration is this one. So this I is the moment of inertia and A is the area of cross section. So whatever, I mean, if we are finding radius of gyration for any section, then what we do is we generally find out the moment of inertia of that section and area of cross section of that section. And simply if we have these two values, we can simply calculate the radius of gyration. And once we find the radius of gyration, we can use here this value to calculate the value of lambda. So this is the whole process that we are going to follow to calculate the this value, which is FCD. So now we will start our solution. So first step will be to determine the properties of the steel column, because as we know that in this case we have I section and plate section. So first of all, we will find out the properties of the I section from the steel table. So we have already seen in the previous example also, how do we find out the property of any section. So here also I will show you. In this case, we have to find out the properties of ISHB, because we are using ISHB in this example. So again, we will see the properties of this ISHB in this steel table. So now I will show you the steel table. So here in the table, you can see we are using ISHB 250. So here there are two values, ISHB 250, and then it is marked ISHB 250 star. Well, there is a little difference between these two. There is only a difference in weight and a little difference in the dimensions. So basically, we are going to take the second one, which is star marked. So in this case, the mass of the section is given and sectional area is given 69.7 centimeter square. And then the depth, which is H value, it is given here. Then the B value. And similarly, the thickness of web, thickness of flange, and flange slope. So all the values are given here. And also IX. IX is given here as 7980. So again, in the new code which we are using, which is IS800, in the IS800, we will refer IX as IZ. So I will show you that. So again, this IX we are referring as IZ. Okay, so IZ value is given here, which is this one. And similarly, the I value will be as it is, which is 2010 centimeter to the power 4. Similarly, the value of radius of gyration for I section, it is given here. So again, Rx, it is referred to as Rz. So Rz is also given here for the I section, not for the plate section. It is given only for the I section. Similarly for Ry, the value is given here. So all the values we will note down and we will write that. So now I'm going there on the slide. So from the steel table, we can note down the values, like this one. So these are the values which are given here. So area of cross section of the I section, similarly the moment of inertia of the I section, and moment of inertia about YY axis for the I section, and thickness of flange, which is this one, this value. So this is the thickness of flange. Okay, so this is the values which is given for the I section only, but we have to find out the I value for these plates also, because to calculate the radius of gyration, we need to find out this radius of gyration for the combined section, not from the for the single section. So we know that R is equals to I by A under root. So in this case, I will be the I of combined section. Similarly, area also, area will be the total area, area of cross section for the I section and area of cross section for these two plates. So in this case, what we are going to do is we have to find out I and A for the combined section. So now In the second step, we will determine the radius of variation for the compound section. Okay, so this radius of variation that I have shown you in the steel table, that was for the I section only, not for the plates. So here we are going to find out for the combined section. Now, how do we find out that? That we have to see. So again, we have to remember that R is equals to I by A. So in that case, we have to find out this I first. So I value for the I section is already mentioned here, which is for the ZZ, this is the value, and for YY, this is the value. Now we have to find out IZZ for the plates. Similarly, IYY for these two plates. Okay. And then what we have to do is, once we find out I'm writing here IZZ for the combined section. So it will be the sum of IZZ of the I section plus IZZ of the plate section. Okay, and in this case we are using two plates, so we can multiply this by two. Okay, so this we have to ultimately find out this IZZ combined. Now how do we find out that we have to see. So in this case, IZZ for the I section, we already know this one. We have to find out this IZZ for the plate, and both plates are of same size, so that is why, and also at the same distance. So from the Z axis, both the plates are at same distance, which is 125. So that is why we are multiplying this by 2. Now, to find out the moment of inertia of this plate, and this plate about this Z axis, we need to understand how do we find out the moment of inertia of any section about any particular axis. So that I will show you. So first, for example, there is this section, which is a rectangular section. Say this is B and this is D. So the CG of this section can be this one. So this is the CG. So if I say this axis as AA and this axis as YY, so in that case, if I have to find out moment of inertia of this plate section about AA, so this will become BD cube by 12. Similarly, if I have to find out moment of inertia of this rectangular section about the YY, then it will become DB cube by 12. Now, if I have to find out the moment of inertia of this section about any unknown axis, say for example, if I have to find out moment of inertia of this plate about Z axis. So this Z axis is at a distance, say for example, this distance is Y. So if it is at a distance Y from the Z axis, then how do we find out that? Well, for that, we will use a theorem which is called parallel axis theorem. Parallel axis theorem. So in the parallel axis theorem, what it says that moment of inertia of any section about any axis, any unknown axis, will be the sum of moment of inertia about the centroidal axis, which will be parallel to the unknown axis about which we have to find out the moment of inertia, and the product of area of section and the distance between the centroidal axis and the unknown axis. Now I will write here, first of all, parallel axis theorem. According to parallel axis theorem, if I have to find out moment of inertia of this section about ZZ, so I will write here IZZ. So IZZ will be the sum of first moment of inertia of this section about AA, because you can see axis AA is parallel to ZZ. So moment of inertia about AA will be, I'm writing here IAA, plus the product of area of cross section of this section and square of the distance, between axis AA and ZZ, which is distance Y. So in that case, I will write area of cross section, which will become B into D, multiplied by the square of the distance between the axis, unknown axis, and the centroidal axis, which is parallel to this. So in that case, it will become y square. So this is how we find out. So IAA will become BD cube by 12 plus B into D multiplied by y square. And this y is basically the distance between the central axis and the z axis. So this is how we find out the moment of inertia about any unknown axis. Similarly, about the y axis, we can simply find out like here db cube by 12. Okay, so this is how we find out moment of inertia. So now we will find out on the slide. So there you can see. First, I will erase it. Okay, so here, if we are trying to find out moment of inertia of this plate about this axis, so you can see, like for this plate, this zz axis is the unknown axis. So again, we will use the same phenomena, which is, so first we will find out this distance. So this distance will be 125 plus half of the 16. It will become 133. So this is the distance. The same distance will be here, which is here it is written as y1. I have taken example by taking y value. So now you can see IAA is the moment of inertia about this axis, which is passing through the centroid of the plate. So this becomes AA. Okay, and AP is the area of the plate. So area of plate, say this is B and this is the D, which is say thickness of the plate, which is 16 mm. And Y1 is the distance between the centroid and the Z axis. So this becomes Y1. So all the values, if we put up here, then we can simply find out the value here. So there you can see B into D cube. D is the thickness of the plate, which is 16 mm cube. So BD cube by 12 plus area of, so this is the area and this value is the y1 whole square. Okay, so this is how we calculate the moment of inertia of the plate about z axis. And we are multiplying this by 2. Why? Because both plates are at the same distance from the z axis. So that is why the moment of inertia can be combined as multiplied by the 2. So now by solving, we can find out IZZ as IZZ of the plate as 17001.92 into 10^5, 10^4 mm to the power 4. Okay, so now total IZZ will be the sum of IZZ of the I section plus IZZ of the plate section. Okay, so now I have written the same value here. Now by summing up, the value of IZZ of the combined section is this one. So now we can find out the radius of gyration, but before that we will find out area of cross section for the total plates and I section here. So area of built up section will be, this is the area of cross section for the I section, and there are two plates, so 2 multiplied by the area of cross section. So this is the width of plate and this is the thickness of the plate. So this is how we calculate the area of cross section, which is 16571. So now we got the value of IZZ of the combined section, area of cross section of the combined section. Now we can find out the radius of gyration for this. So radius of gyration in this case will be IZZ upon A, and putting all the values, we can find out the radius of gyration about ZZ axis of this combined section as 122.79 mm. Similarly, we will find out radius of gyration about the y axis. But in this case, you can see the y axis of this I section and the y axis of this plate, they both are coinciding on the same point. So CG of the plate is this one. Okay, y axis is passing through the CG of I section and through the plate also. At the same time, CG of plate will be here. Similarly, CG of the I section is here. So all the CG are in the same line, which means there is no need to apply the parallel axis theorem. So in this case, directly we can multiply by 2. So 2 into db cube by 12. So in this case, the moment of inertia will become like this. While in the earlier case, when we were calculating Izz, you can see the centroidal axis of the plate was this one, and centroidal axis of this plate was this one. So you can see all three lines are separate by a distance. But in case of calculation of Iyy, the CG of all three sections lies in the same line. So that is why there is no need to apply the parallel axis theorem. So we can directly calculate the moment of inertia about the centroidal axis, about y axis for both of the plate. Okay, so that is why I have written here Iyy of the plate directly as 2 multiplied by db cube by 12. So d here is the thickness, which is 16 mm, and b cube is the width of the plate. So there is no need to multiply with the area and the distance, because there is no distance between them. So that is why Iyy is calculated as 7200 into 10 raised to power 4 mm to the power 4. So that is the Iyy. So now we can find out Ryy also. So Ryy is, sorry, first we need to find out total Iyy. So this Iyy is the of the I section, and this is of the plate section. So by totaling it, we get total Iyy as 9211.7 into 10 to the power 4. Now we can find out the radius of gyration about the y axis also. By putting all the values, we can find out Ryy as 74.56. So now you can see in the previous slide, the Rzz value was 122, and now Ryy value is 74. So we have seen that in the previous example that the radius of gyration, which is low, the minimum radius of gyration will give us the critical value of design stress. So FCD will be adopted for the radius of gyration, which will be the minimum. So in that case, we will find out minimum radius of gyration. So minimum radius of gyration will be the minimum of Ryy and Rzz. So Ryy is having 74, Rzz was 122. So this is the minimum value. So that is why we are taking minimum radius of gyration, because this will give us the critical design stress, this one, FCD. So we always adopt the minimum value of radius of gyration. So now we found the radius of gyration. Now what we were supposed to find out? We were supposed to find out the lambda, which is the slenderness ratio. So for the lambda, the formula is KL upon R minimum. So KL is the effective length. So now we will find out the effective length first. But before calculating the effective length, first we will see the buckling curve classification for our built-up section. So built-up section belongs to which curve? We will see that in table 10. So now I will be showing you the IS code. So in the IS code, we will see which buckling class our section belongs to. Because this is a very important step, because in this we try to find out which table we will use to find out the value of FCD, and that depends on the buckling class, which you can see here, it is written on the fourth column. So in our case, we are using the built-up member. So in that case, first one is the rolled I section. Second one is the welded I section, and third one is the hollow section, welded box section. Then in the next, it is a channel angle T and solid section. And in the last, we see the built up member. So this time, this section belongs to our case, because in our case, we are calculating the compressive strength for the built up member. So built up member can be composed of any section. It may be composed of channel section or I section or I along the plate section. So in that case, It says that buckling can occur about any axis. It may occur about Z axis as well as it may occur about the Y axis. So it may occur about any axis. And in that case, the buckling class will be C, which means we will use table 9C to get the value of FCD. So now I will show you table 9C also, because table 9C, yes, there you can see. So we will use this table 9C as per buckling class, and to get the value of FCD, we need to find out the value of FY. So FY is already known, which is 250, but we need to find out KL by R. Well, KL is the effective length and R is the radius of gyration. So once we find out this value, we will again come to this table to find out the value of FCD. So there we can write that from the table 10 of IS 800 for built up section, buckling class is C about any axis. So now we will find out first the effective length. Effective length of column can be found out using table 11 of the IS code. So first of all, we will see again the end conditions, and based on the end conditions, we find out the effective length. So first I will show you the end conditions, which is given in the question. So in the question, you can see that it is given that assume that the bottom of the column is fixed and top is hinged. So we say that our column is like this. So bottom is fixed, which is like the notation for this is like this, and hinged. For hinged, it is formed like this. So this is the case of our column. From bottom, it is fixed, and from the top, it is hinged. Okay, so for this condition, we will see the effective length from the IS code. So this is the table 11. So in the table 11, we will find out the effective length. So as we know that our column is fixed from one end and hinged from the other end. So what happens in the fixed condition? In the fixed condition, translation and rotation both are restrained. And in case of hinged, translation is restrained, but rotation is free. So we will see that in our condition. So there you can see, this is the symbol. So it is showing the hinged point and it is showing the fixed condition. So there you can see translation and rotation both are restrained, and translation is restrained from on the other end while the rotation is free. So that is why you can see that buckling is showing the rotation, but in the fixed end there is no rotation. So in that case, the effective length will be 0.8 times of L. So in this case, K value will be 0.8. So that is our effective length. L is the length of column. So now we will go to our slide to calculate the effective length. So from the table 11, the effective length is 0.8 times of L, and L value is already given in the question, which is 4 meter. So we are converting this 4 meter into mm to calculate the effective length into mm. So effective length comes out as 3200. So now we have the effective length, we have the R minimum, we can find out the lambda value, which is KL by R. So putting all the values, R minimum we have already calculated, KL we have just calculated. So lambda value is 42.92. So now we found the value of lambda. So from the table 9C of IS 800 and FY value of 250 MPa and lambda of this value, we can find out the value of FCD. So again, I will show you in the IS code. So this is our table 9C to calculate the value of FCD. Okay, so our value of lambda is 42. So which means the value of FCD will lie between 40 and 50. So corresponding to 40, the value of FCD for having FY value as 250. So for this, if the lambda value is 40, the FCD value is 198. If the lambda value is 50, the FCD value is 183, which means our lambda value is 42 point something. So our FCD value will lies between 198 and 183. So for that, again, we have to do the interpolation So I have done the interpolation on the slide. So we will see that there. So there we can see I have done the interpolation 198 minus 198 minus 83, and the difference between the lambda value was 10, which is 40 and 50, and difference between the required value of lambda and the minimum value of lambda, which is 40, is 2.92. So by calculating it, we find out the FCD value as 193.62 Newton per mm square. So this is how we find out the FCD. So now we found the FCD value. Now we have the A value. We can simply calculate the design strength. So design strength in this case will be PD, and PD was the product of FCD and AE. So we have already calculated AE, FCD we have just calculated. So now we can find out the value of design strength as 3208.48 kilonewton. So this is our design strength of the compound section in this case. So that is the solution of our example 2. Thank you.